Since we now know we're gathering a sample and analyzing that sample in order to make inferences about the population, when we make that analysis of that sample, it's going to help if we know what kind of variables, and i.e. what type of information, we're gathering about that sample. So that leads us to try to categorize our variables. Now, there's qualitative variables and quantitative variables. Qualitative variables are variables that are some attribute or characteristic. You cannot perform meaningful calculations on these. You can't add them up and divide by 5 and get anything useful, right? Now, they can be numeric, but the numbers themselves would not be mathematically useful. That's qualitative variables. So just notice they can be numbers, but they have to be numbers that are not mathematically useful. Now, you might be thinking, what in the world does that mean? Well, an example of that would be, say, your social security number. Right? So your social security number, just as an example, is not a number that you can perform a meaningful calculation on. So it's a number, but it's a qualitative variable. Now, quantitative variables are numeric values that can have meaningful calculations. And then there are two subtypes of quantitative variables. There's quantitative discrete and quantitative continuous. And that distinction there is actually a bigger deal than you might think. Discrete variables are either countable or they're finite. So there's a limited number of possible values, and often both, right? So countable can be infinite. So for example, the integers or the whole numbers from 0, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, going on forever, right? It's infinite, but it's counted. You're literally counting them. So that's a discrete number, right? Discrete variables cannot take on every possible value between two numbers, so between two limits. So it can't be 1.234528321. That's not possible. It's either 1 or it's 2, but that's it, right? So that would be discrete. Discrete is when it can be 1, 2, 3. You can count them, right? In general, it's counted with no decimal places. There are some exceptions to that. So the decimal place thing, the exceptions to that would be technically money, because money is limited to the penny, except at the gas pump, which is a whole other thing. But so it's often money, but shoe size is another one, which we'll see down below. But shoe size in the US can be 4, 4.5, 5, 5.5, 6. So even though there's a 0.5 in there, it still is counted, right? There's a finite number of them. And often, but not always, often money. Because money only goes to the hundredths place, right? So since it's, 1, 2.34, and that's it, you're never going to go past that. So often money is discrete, but we generally treat it as continuous because it has those decimal places, so it's annoying. So we'd rather treat it as continuous. Nevertheless, it is technically discrete. All right, now a continuous variable has decimal places, right? But it's anything that is not countable. It has an infinite number of possible values that are not possible to be counted, right? So it could be 12.361425, right? That's possible, right? That's a continuous variable. So it has decimal places. It could have more decimal places if you just have a better instrument for measuring. It can take on any possible value between two limits. So if you say, hey, my lowest number is 0, my highest number is 3, it could be any decimal in between those two. It could be 2, as a matter of fact, but it could also be 2.01453, right? Discrete can't do that. Discrete is either 2 or it's 3, or maybe 2.5 if you count the shoe size thing, but that's about it. In general, think of it always as discrete is counted, right? So discrete is something you're counting. Continuous is something you're measuring. If it's anything you would measure in a science class with like a graduated cylinder, right? If it has units like volume or length or width or weight, right? Height, all of those things, time, right? Those are continuous, because you're measuring it with a measurement device, right? So anything from science class is continuous. Now, that's not to say that you're going to get all the decimal places. It's just that you could get more decimal places if you have a better instrument, whereas discrete would be counted. Now, let's look at an example, because it'll all be clearer, of course, with an example. So we have three types. We have qualitative, quantitative discrete, and quantitative continuous, right? So we're subsecting quantitative into two groups. All right, let's start with the name. Well, your name is qualitative, so I'm going to give it an L for qualitative, right? Because I can't do a meaningful calculation on your name. Your name is your name. Same thing with patient number. Ah, there's a tricky one, because even though it's a number, there's no meaningful calculation. It's like the social security number. It's not like I can just, if you want to think about a meaningful calculation, always think about the mean. Can you add them up and divide by how many there are? Which you probably think of as average, right? But again, it's not the only type of average there is, but nevertheless, can you find that, right? Can you find that arithmetic mean? If you can't, then it's not quantitative, it's qualitative. The year you were born. Okay. The year you were born is discrete. That you can do a meaningful calculation on. So for example, if you know what year somebody was born, let's say they were born in 2000, then you know they're about 20 right now, right? You're doing a meaningful calculation. Or if you know one sibling was born in 2000 and another sibling was born in 2005, you could add them up and divide by two and find out the average year for that family to have children. So that's discrete. I'm going to color code these here. So qualitative, quantitative, discrete. Whether or not you had the flu vaccine last year. Now think about that. So if you're a patient coming in, which is what we were assuming this was, and the nurse asks you, did you have the flu vaccine last year? Have you had the flu vaccine? Your response will be, yes, I had it, or no, I didn't have it. So that's qualitative. Now your body temperature, right? However they choose to measure it on you, thermometer with those little ray gun things, or when they put it up to your temple. One way or another, they're using a measuring tool because it's a measurement. So that would be continuous. You can get more decimal places if you just have a better thermometer. Blood pressure is exactly the same thing. Blood pressure is completely measured. They put the little cuff on you and they're measuring you. So that's continuous, right? You can get more fine-tuned measurements if you just have more accurate tools. Now, shoe size, I already mentioned earlier, shoe size is actually discrete. You can do a meaningful calculation in that you know somebody with a shoe size 10, for example, is larger than a person with shoe size 9. But that's about the extent of it. You can't do too much more. And you do know that even though it has decimals, even though it has 5.5 and 6.5, that's okay because there's a finite, right? Finite meaning not infinite, a select number of values, and that's all there is. You get up to NBA player size, and that's about the end of it. Now, that's in contrast to the length of your foot. If I have you step on that little device that they have you step on at the shoe stores, and I measure the length of your foot in centimeters or in inches, that would be continuous, right? Because it's a measurement in centimeters or inches, depending on what country you're in. You can get more accurate if you just have a better measuring tool. So your length of your foot might be, you know, who knows, 10, I don't know how long a foot is, 10.362 inches, right? So, but if I get a better tool, I could be saying, oh, it's 10.362512 inches, right? So better tool means more decimal places, which means it's continuous. Anything you measure is continuous. Your service rating. Ooh, poor, fair, good, right? So how was your service today? That's qualitative. You cannot do really meaningful calculations on it. Now your pain level on a scale from 1 to 10, it's a bit up for debate. So it's actually qualitative, because how much worse is a 10 than a 9, for example, right? That's not the same thing as shoe size. I mean, shoe size, anybody who has a size 10 foot tries to put their foot in a size 7 shoe will know real quick that those kind of calculations are meaningful. But pain level here is very personal. It's very arbitrary. It's actually L. However, most doctors, hospitals, everybody, due to a big push on pain from the 1990s and early 2000s, which is a whole other discussion, they treat it like it's D. So we will too a lot of the time. So even though it's L, we're actually going to treat it like it's discrete. We'll say, oh, a 7 is worse than a 6. A 6 is worse than a 5. How much worse? Nobody knows. That's one of the reasons it's really L, because that calculation isn't meaningful. However, because of a big push in the medical industry to not have people and be in pain, we tend to treat those as if they're discrete. Same thing with service ratings. You know, how was your rating today of your service? So if they put that on a 1 through 10 scale, then they magically treat it like it's a number. It isn't. It's really a non-meaningful calculation. However, that's not reflective of reality. So it's treated like it's discrete, but it's actually L. Hopefully you won't get one of those on a test, because we don't generally ask you one that's like that. If we do, we would try to be specific about what we're talking about. So in general, pick D, even though it's really truly L. Now your weight, there's no question about that, right? Scale, right? So your weight is continuous. How much weight you've gained or lost, say during a time in the hospital, that's continuous, right? So these are measurements that you make with a scale. Anything you measure with a device that would be in science class, that's continuous. Now age is continuous, because every second you're getting older, right? So you are not, well, let's think about this. When you round it to the nearest year, it's discrete. So let's pretend that you're 20 years old. Why not? It's a fun year. All right. So you're not really 20 years old. That's what everybody says. But everybody knows, if they talk to a mom with a small child, an infant. So, oh, they're 7 days old. Oh, they're, 12 hours old, right? They're letting you know, right? You're really 20 years, 7 months, 5 days, 15 days, I'll make you 15 days. And then 20 hours, 42 minutes, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. You can go down to seconds, et cetera, and beyond. There was an interesting, interesting is one word for it. There was a movie with Justin Timberlake many years ago that had like little clocks on everybody's arms, and that was how much time you had left to live. It was kind of a play on this a little bit, right? Everybody has decimal time, right? You're alive decimal number of years, but we just don't treat it like that. We just round. So in reality, this is what you are. Your age is continuous. However, we often just round. So this is the way we treat it. We treat it like it's discrete, right? We say, oh, I'm 20, I'm 21, right? We don't say I'm 20, blah, 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 blah. Like, we don't do that. So we treat it as adults. But again, if you talk to anybody with an infant, especially in their first year of life, oh, well, you hear it. Oh, that baby is 7 months and 3 days and 2 hours. Oh, because they're so excited that they've had the child alive for that long, right? So it's fine. But that's actually a more accurate way of describing what your life actually is like. But nobody lives like that. It would drive you crazy all the time. So we just round to the nearest year.